there I was, sitting in the darkened auditorium, tears streaming down my face. As I watched my sister Tracy in the spotlight, curtain on this side, curtain on this side, the only person on the stage, telling part of her life story about recovery from mental illness. She was so nervous that she was hanging onto a lectern with one hand. She was shaking so much that you could see the vibration in her pants. And yet, she persevered. She persevered and went through and completed the words that she intended to read. I don't know that I've ever seen anything so courageous in my entire life. And you can tell how much it meant to me, because all my emotion comes up when I think about it. My little sister, only a year younger than me, so I'm still little too. Hanging on for dear life as she shared her story. She was one of 8, maybe 10 people who were part of an inaugural program being held in White Rock for people recovering from mental health illness. And the name of the program was Truth Be Told. And for the last previous 6 weeks, 8 weeks, they had met as a group and been guided through discussing their mental illness. And then the program culminated with this presentation where each of them got to stand up and read and share some of their experiences. And some shared once, and others shared more detail and spoke 2 or 3 times. And there were things that I learned in that program that touched me so deeply that I want to share with us as a community, because it was a reminder to me about how we need to treat each other, not just the people who walk the same walk that we walk, but those who are marginalized or different than we are. It was a very, very powerful experience, and I share it with you today. And before I do some of the detail, I want to set the context for you in scripture. This is one of my mother's favorite scriptures. And it talks about the king. The king will say, "Come, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then they said to him, "Lord, when? When were you sick? When were you in prison? and the king in Matthew chapter 25, verse 40 says, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of those who are members of my family, you did it to me." Just as you did it to one of those who are the least of my family, you did it to me. That's the umbrella that we work from, that we're all connected, that what we do to someone, we do to all. And it's a wonderful reminder that we are all, especially on Mother's Day, reminded that we are all one family. So, what are some of the themes that these magnificent people shared? Because not only did they share what the pain was, but they actually gave me solutions, which I share with you. First, overwhelmingly, there's this sense of isolation, the sense of aloneness. They spoke about how when they were in the psychiatric ward, how powerless they felt. They spoke about how indifferent some people were, some caregivers were, and how kind other caregivers were. They spoke about police officers who were indifferent, and police officers who were kind. And they spoke about the power of just that kind word and what it meant when they are in that alone space. One person called the gentle nurses and the gentle doctors angels. And I thought that was pretty accurate. Because isn't it true that whenever we've been alone, how sometimes just the power of a kind word can make all the difference to our outlook? Nothing was going to change the fact that they were in the psychiatric ward or in some sort of crisis. But never underestimate the power of a kind look or a kind word when someone is in pain. And so what it reminded me about, and what I invite us all to consider, is how often do we treat people with indifference? How often do we see them but not really see them? And I realized when I thought about it more and more that it's not unkindness that necessarily is the antidote to isolation. It's indifference. Rather than being intentionally unkind, no one's intentionally unkind, but maybe instead of seeing through somebody, we need to consider becoming a little bit more present to who they are and what they might be experiencing as they're going through whatever Gethsemane moment they might be going through. How do we treat the people who are alone? How do we treat newcomers here on a Sunday? Do we greet them, or do we trust that the ushers will do it and go on to our own thing? When we're at the grocery store and someone is struggling with something, isn't it easier just to be indifferent? And yet, isn't it true that the power of a kind act or a kind word can transform? And so I invite us to consider that we treat every situation with kindness. Find this week something to do that is kind for someone without them knowing, potentially. But even if they do know, what's the harm? Isolation, the pain of being alone, can be remedied with kindness. Then, the other common theme that came out of these presentations was this sense of shame and stigma. One woman shared how she knew that if she had had diabetes, a heart attack, a broken leg, any one of other things that would land her in hospital, she would have had all kinds of visitors. But she was in the psychiatric ward, and nobody came. She shared how powerful it was that her pastor actually came to visit her. Another person shared how she was so embarrassed at the thought of needing antipsychotic drugs that she wouldn't go and get her prescription filled. And yet mental illness is something that is possible for all of us. A lot of people have experienced mental illness or mental health challenges as a result of some catastrophe happening in their life. And sometimes the path between coping and not coping is pretty thin. For one person, it was the loss of his mother. And yet, the antidote to all of that, that idea of stigma and shame, is simply acceptance. And so one of the things that they did as an exercise is they stood up each week and said, I am a survivor. I had mental illness. I have mental illness, and I'm a survivor. And so they started to claim that just because I have a mental illness does not mean that I'm not part of society. And isn't it true for us that we have a hard time accepting people who don't toe the line and walk the way we do, or dress the way we do, or even think the way we do? And yet on this day, on Mother's Day, of all days, let us remember that those babies were children of a mother too, deserving of acceptance, deserving of our unconditional love, because what we do to the least of these, our family, we do to all. So maybe this week, in search of acceptance, let us just be okay with differences. Sometimes the differences are in our own head, right? Sometimes we know that we have things that we don't want to think. We shouldn't be thinking that. We shouldn't behave like that. We shouldn't. Let us just be okay. What's so bad about going, oh, there's a thought. There's a belief. There's someone different than me. There's someone going through a challenge with two screaming babies in a lineup somewhere. Let us suspend the judgment that says that you should not. And then third, they spoke of despair and fear. And they spoke of the antidote to fear and despair, which is hope. And I was so moved by this young lad named Alex, who got up and he said, mental health is not a death sentence. Recovery is to be expected. And I thought, wow. Mental health is not a death sentence. Recovery is to be expected. And yet, isn't it true that when we see people who sometimes are on the streets, who are in a place of despair, that we tend to want to kind of not look at that and write it off? And to be able instead to hold hope, to hold the promise that tomorrow is another day, to hold what Jerry shared with me and I have shared with you before, the idea of the semicolon, the idea that this is not the end of the sentence, it's just another thought. Can we be the voice of hope for people who are in despair? Whether there are people suffering from mental illness or not doesn't matter at this point. It's just to do with the idea of being the presence of something that's uplifting. Something that's uplifting when someone is feeling down. What is the next most loving thing you can say or do? That's all that we need to do. And so, that day, I looked at my sister with new eyes. I looked at mental illness and mental health with new eyes. Because I heard the pain and I heard the antidote. I heard isolation, kindness. I heard shame and stigma, acceptance. I heard despair and fear, hope, love. Wow. We are to be God expressing on this earth. Let us treat all of the people that we meet, not just the healthy ones, but all of us, all of our family, where there is pain, let us be the presence of kindness. Where there is shame and stigma and judgment, Let us be the presence of acceptance. And where there is fear and despair, let us be the presence of hope and love. We are all indeed one family. Mental illness is not a death sentence. Recovery is to be expected. And the lessons that were taught that day for me were powerful beyond measure. Kind, accept, hope. Happy Mother's Day.